Hey, ik heb ook een Kings of Indigo broek aan.
Nou,
ik verdomme, dat zijn we sustainable. En ik zeg
Maar zo zie ik je maar voor de helft. Nu sta ik hier. Ja, jij moet meer.
Ik moet meer naar jou nog, hè?
Zo zou het perfect zijn. Met Jim in de hoek.
En Jim.
Oh ja. Are you ready? English mode on.
Yes. Oh ja.
Hello, my beautiful friends. Today I am with Roanne.
Yay!
And we are gonna talk about stress-free productivity because you know everything about it, apparently.
I'm very stress-free and I'm very productive.
Yeah. Yeah. How come?
I'm programs.
Je moet iets naar mij.
Ja.
How come?
I'm a researcher and I've done research on this team for over a decade. And I'm also a writer and
a very good one.
A mentor for a lot of creatives. And so I combine my writing with being a researcher and being a mentor and being a trainer. So I kind of had to be productive, but I also didn't want to go along in the rat race. And so I developed a manner of working where you can basically do much more in much less time without feeling constantly overwhelmed or without feeling the pressure. Yeah. And that's what I teach to people all over the world.
So can you share some of your best tips with us today?
Yes, I would love to. So I think my very first best tip would be to forget all about time management. It's so popular to say, you know, oh, I'm giving you these productivity hacks and then you can do more in less time. And this is how you type faster. And this is how you can, you know,
work in blocks and everything.
All these things. What, you know, I follow all these courses because it's part of my work. Yeah. But what I find is that they only make you busier. They only allow you to become more efficient. It's really not going to produce the best work. And, you know, I'm a writer. And so my books, they have to be really good. It's really important for me that I give my readers the best I can do. And I know I can do more, but it's not necessarily going to be the best thing I can do.
Yeah.
So instead of time management, I always advise people to start focusing on energy management. So really don't manage your time. Don't try to do more in one day, but instead learn to understand how your body works. A lot of people know there's a rhythm between day and night, right? Like you have 8 hours of sleep and then you have 8 hours of work and then you have 8 hours of relaxation. Mm. A lot of people know that rhythm, but there's also a different rhythm that runs through our bodies and we don't know about those. They're called the ultradian rhythms. And you'll know probably the story from when you're asleep, you go from super deep sleep to not so duper deep sleep, right? Mm. That rhythm is a 90 minute cycle and it works through your day as well.
Ah,
and so if you look at our brains below in a scan, for example, you'll see that we're not able to focus 8 hours. Instead, all of us have cycles and it's either 45 minutes or it's 90 minutes, but it's somewhere in between, probably. Mm. Some people have like 20 minutes peak. I offer people an exercise where I teach them how they can understand their own rhythm. And then if you start with those cycles, you'll actually notice that you'll constantly work on your highest energy and it will just give you the most productive work. And if you do that, you don't need all the hours in a day.
Yeah.
You can just do the best work within 4 hours because you'll make use of your own body.
Yeah, and you just have to know your cycle.
Yeah. And a lot, you know, if people are interested, they can find it at roannevanvoorst.com/focus. They can find the exercise and it's for free. There's no hassle there because it's really life changing.
I will link it down below as well.
Yeah. Cool.
Cool. That's a very good tip. I think that's the main annoyance for me, at least for people who really have the 9-to-5 jobs and also bosses who really expect to work productively for 8 hours. Like, that doesn't exist, right?
No, it's a very old-fashioned idea. I mean, it came from the 60s when we had a lot of factory work. Mm-hmm. And I mean, if you work in a factory, it was actually a plus because before that, they were not protected at all.
Mm-hmm.
And so they had to work like 16 hours. And then came a law that said, oh, you know, 8 hours probably enough.
Yeah.
And that was perfect for the time. But nowadays, with all of our, you know, we're thinkers, we're creators, we sit behind a computer, it's really not, it's not gonna happen.
Yeah.
8 hours of productive work is impossible.
Doesn't make any sense. No.
If I write a novel, I can write 2, 3, 4 hours. And after that, it's down the drain. And so I better stop and do something nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. Forget to-do lists. Like, seriously.
That's very radical, because I'm actually from the to-do list.
I know. I know.
So tell me more.
I used to be very much from the to-do list. I used to be a to-do list addict. I would even put things on the to-do list after I had already done them,
yes,
in order to cross them out.
To feel good.
Yeah, I know. It's like instant feel good.
Yeah.
The reason why I teach people not to work with to-do lists is because I think oftentimes what you put on your to-do list are the things that you don't want to forget, right? So they're the tiny tasks, like all the little things that you have to do. Mm. Oh, I don't want to forget about this. Okay. And then of course, like, the striping them away gives you a super good feeling because you've done your tiny task.
Yeah.
But they also distract you from the deeper task, from the long-term goal. So basically your to-do lists are the equivalents of short-term goals.
Like, yeah,
this is what I need to do today.
Yeah. But which can be helpful in
absolutely
itself.
And
well,
I'm not saying that you can do anything with them, but I would recommend people to start from a different perspective, to start from thinking about what can I do today that will bring me closer to my long-term goal.
Yeah.
And so of course you need to know what your long-term goals are.
Yeah.
That's not always easy. I spent the first weeks of my year program with people finding exactly out what is your goal, how do you want to live, how do you want to set up your business, you know, what do you want to do.
Yeah.
But as soon as you know that, spending the first 2-3 hours of your day on that long-term goal, and then only after that doing all the nitty-witty, you know, tiny stuff, that really changes the whole day you experience, the whole way you experience your day. So, you know,
your
you don't start with your email.
Mentality.
You're not responding to emails. Instead, you start with what is important to you.
Mm-hmm.
And then all your energy goes there in the morning. And then the energy you have left, you can still do all the answering emails and the to-do list.
Yeah.
You don't have to get rid of your to-do list completely.
Okay, good. Yeah, but I think that the combination would be the best for me as well. I'm really in my procrastination mode as we speak for long-term goals. But if I'm going to work like this, I know that I'm going to start my day with exactly that. And once I'm finished or not in my productivity level anymore, then you can do all the crappy little in-between to-do things, I guess.
Yeah. And I mean, it gives such a fulfilling feeling after, even after like 2 hours of, you know, writing on your book or thinking about where you want to go with your business. It's such a different feeling, and you'll be more energized than after like 2 hours of responding and doing tiny things, you know?
Yeah.
So it's a nice way of working.
Very beautiful one. Good one.
I work 4 hours a day where I'm super productive. And then there's more time for, you know, reading books that I find interesting or listening to podcasts.
Yeah.
And so I think for this is possible for most of us. You just have to kind of learn how to work it.
Mm.
But instead of the very disciplined way, what I do is I try to seduce myself into the deep work. And one of the super simple methods that I sometimes teach to people who are really kind of, they feel intimidated by a project, like it's, you know, you have this plan but you don't know where to start because it's so super big.
Mm-hmm.
And instead of starting, you click on Facebook and you procrastinate like a mofo. Yeah. You know?
Instagram.
Yeah.
Stories.
Instagram. There we go. In order to get away from that, I say, why don't you seduce yourself into the broccoli? So I call this method the broccoli method. And it's like, think of those parents who are teaching a toddler to eat veggies, and they'll be like, here comes the airplane, here comes the monster. And you know, you see the toddler looking at the broccoli and being like, yeah, this is kind of silly, but it kind of works, huh? Okay, I'll eat it.
Yeah.
That's what you can do with yourself as well. So I always try to, if I really feel intimidated by a big project, I try to make it nice for myself.
And how do you do that?
Well, either I go to a coffee shop in the morning where I treat myself on a, you know, cafe latte. And I say to myself, I don't have to stay here very long. I don't have to work very long on this project, but I'm gonna do 1 hour.
Yeah.
And I subdivide the task, like the major task, into 1 or 2 tiny first steps that I can take.
Yeah.
And then I do those, and I say to myself, I have to stop after those. Even if it's going great, I'll just stop. So I'm only going to be here for an hour, and I'll end the hour with an idea what I can do for the next day. Yeah. So I never end when I'm blocked. So I always end with, okay, so tomorrow I can work on this. And it's going to be a tiny task again.
Yeah.
So in that way, you're kind of, you're cutting it down. You're making it kind of attractive. You're sitting in a coffee shop where it's nice. You know, you're giving yourself something nice. There's no such a harsh feeling. It's more like self-care.
Yeah.
It's practice. But still, you're doing something good. And you'll see that afterwards, you'll feel much better than after an hour on Instagram, right?
Mm. Yeah. Much better.
Unless it's her Instagram, then of course it's very... But all the other people's Instagram. So eat your broccoli and do it kindly.
Yeah, and I guess also just really forgetting about the like the pressure that society gives to us that we have to work 8 hours or maybe 10 hours a day and that it's really cool to hustle.
Yeah.
Right? That it's a mindset as well that it's good to just sometimes take a few hours, focused hours, and then be inspired by other things in life again.
Absolutely. And that, I think, links up to the fourth tip, if I may make the bridge.
Number four.
Because maybe this is the most important one. When I started experimenting in my own work life with, you know, being an academic, and I have a team of researchers with whom I work. And so taking the alternative path and taking the path where I speak out loud and say, hey, I'm an academic and still I don't work 80 hours per week. I don't want to work 80 hours per week. Yeah. I love my work, but there's more to Rowan than just the work, you know? Also, I think my best work comes from focus and from commitment and not so much from overwork. Mm. You know, my best work comes from creativity and from longing and from my deeper values. That's my best work.
And usually it comes out in silence and when you're restful.
Absolutely.
Right? Yeah.
Absolutely. So what I really, really recommend people to do is to really find a tribe of like-minded people. Because there's many of us in the world, but we just don't really know. Like oftentimes if you look around in the office, everybody seems to be working the 8 hours and you feel like you're the only one procrastinating, you know, or you think you're the only one with this wonderful idea for a book. I have a lot of people in my program who have fantastic ideas for their first novel or their first book, but they think they're the only one who don't know how to get it started, you know? And so what is really, really important is that you find a couple of people who have the same ideas as you about work and who also feel open to at least experimenting with more energy management over time management or, you know, letting go of the hustle mentality and go into more an aligned mentality. And so, you know, I have a couple of those groups myself where people can become members for free. And it's really nice to inspire, like to hear and read about other people's experiments with that, to be reminded constantly of there are people out there who do it in a different way. Not everybody is hustling all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And this is super important because a lot of us have embodied the rules that basically came from our boss or our parents, because they come from a generation where it was still good to work hard.
Yeah.
But nowadays, with the type of work that we do, I don't think, you know, it's really useful.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really old-fashioned ways of thinking, but we have become those ways of thinking as well.
Yeah, and then I feel guilty when I'm not working, although I notice when I'm not working, I usually write the best articles, for example.
And you also know like that when you were really, really rested, you probably were so inspired after a couple of days that suddenly you have this business idea and it rings, you know?
Definitely.
And I think it's super important for people to constantly be in touch with people who do it in this alternative new way.
Like-minded souls.
Yes.
So, and next to your group, I will link her group down below, of course.
Meet us.
What can
we're
people
awesome.
More do?
I have a program where people really work with me. But what you can also do, if the program is not for you at this moment, find one friend and create with that friend inspiration days.
How can you find that friend?
Just open up about the topic.
Mm-hmm.
I find that often when I start telling, especially in the academic world, right, where it's really super normal to work 100 hours per week and people are proud of it.
Mm.
It's like, how are you doing? Oh, super busy. Oh, really? I'm overworking. Oh, really? I was burnt out last month, you know? And people really, it's a status thing.
Yeah.
And I think it's insane. And I don't think it's something to be proud of because it's only telling me that you're doing something wrong with your agenda or with your priorities and that you're work probably comes from a place of scarcity and like hurry and, you know, shallowness.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm really not impressed by that.
Yeah.
Only when I start opening up about that topic, only when I sometimes admit out loud in the midst of a meeting saying, hey, this is really too long for me. You know, this is not where my best work comes from. I need to be outside. I need to walk in the forest. I need to, you know, then suddenly more and more people go, oh, really? I have this problem as well.
Yeah.
And so that might be another way to just really be open and say, for me, it's not working the 8 hours. Yeah. Can we find another way?
I guess that's in general, to be open, that you will find the like-minded people.
That's always the case, right? Yeah.
Cool. That's it, right? For now.
For now, yeah. And I mean, people can always get in touch or listen to the podcast, which will be launched in September.
What will the podcast be about?
It will be very weird. Because I will just basically shut up for an hour.
You can basically listen to her working.
Yeah, that's probably it. Like, I'm laptop. Working on my new book, and I'm inviting people from all over the world to tune in on the work energy and do one focused hour. It's the Focus Hour podcast of work with me. And so you'll just hear me in silence, and I'll say hi in the beginning.
Yeah.
But then, you know, I'll set my alarm, and so people can turn off their alarms and just focus on one task. It works for so many people.
Mm-hmm.
Like for freelancers, people who work at home, if you feel like you're becoming distracted, and it really works to know that on the other side of the frequency, there's another person working on a book, working on a long-term goal. You're not alone.
Yeah.
And so that might be one other way. Like people really, it's so cool to just collectively get into this work frequency, and it works in the energy.
Yeah.
It really does. So yeah, get in touch with me, and I'm always happy to help out.
Thank you so much.
I was super happy to be here. Thank you.
I loved every tip. I really, really admire and really like just your whole angle in this whole subject, because I really think that the things that you now said is something that we don't really hear nowadays, that it all has to be about the hustle and it all has to be about like work, work, work. But instead, we can also look at it a tiny bit differently. So thank you so much.
And try it out and let me know how it goes.
Yeah, I will. Thank you guys so much for watching. I hope to see you in the next one. And don't forget to keep letting love rule. Bye.